Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church.
Good morning.
I want everybody that's watching us on Facebook and YouTube to know that if you're not here in person, you're missing the in-person effect of the first Sunday after Christmas. So, Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merry Christmas.
It's great to be here with you today. The service is going to be a little bit relaxed,
yeah.
But we're going to worship the Lord, we're going to be joyous, and we're thankful to be here. Pastor, do you have anything you'd like to say?
Just a few things.
Ooh, always catches me by surprise. Good morning. It is so good to be with you who have come to be with us in person, for those of you who are with us virtually on Facebook right now, or throughout the week, or even through YouTube. We are delighted you are here, and if you're in the area, we'd invite you one of these coming Sundays, maybe just to come and check it out. We'd love to have you here with us, and we do think that there is something special about being in this place together. But if you are with us virtually, whether you're family or from far away, we'd love for you to just to give us a shout, leave a comment, or get in touch with the church. Just let us know where you're from, and we'd love to connect with you and help you even virtually plant roots here with us at Ashtonville First. Let's take some time to pause, refresh for the week ahead, and just kind of take that big sigh, that exhale that comes with the holidays slowly passing as we prepare for worship this week with meditation to music and by inviting the light of Christ into our service.
Thank you.
Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here. And we ask that your Spirit come into this place wherever we find ourselves, and that it empowers us and encourages us to give to you the entirety of our hearts, our minds, and our bodies, and our souls in the year ahead as we worship you, the living God. Amen. Leave them at the table as you eat, or even if you a little bit unfortunately, I won't be able to see them at this moment, but you're welcome to leave those with us if you feel comfortable sharing that. You're also welcome to, more privately, share your concerns via phone or email as well. And because we want to pray together, specifically, we want to pray with each other. I do have one name that is not on our list that I would like to add. That is my mom's cousin, and I'm not sure exactly how cousins work, so I don't know exactly what that makes her to me, but she's my mom's cousin. Her name's Crystal, and Crystal is currently on a ventilator in the ICU down in Tennessee. She does have COVID-19. The latest updates we received that she is now responsive, doing slightly better, but still not necessarily in a good place. So if we just keep Crystal Coy in our prayers, that would be much appreciated by the Watkins clan. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, as we come together after the presents have been opened and the meal shared and the time spent together with people whom we care so much about, we are filled, overflowing, one might say, with love. We give you thanks for the opportunity we had to see each other and to spend time with those we care about. But also we give you thanks for the opportunity that we got to express our love for those people. Whether it was through time we spent with them, maybe it was a gift given or a gift received. We know that all good things come from you, and so for this blessed Christmas season, we give you thanks. We also recognize, O God, that this is not the easiest season for some of our loved ones. And if we're being honest, sometimes even for ourselves. Send your presence out to them, O God. And put those people in your heart, but also put them on our hearts. Allow us the courage and the obedience to reach out to those who desperately need to feel your love and presence this Christmas season. We also come to you, O God, bearing with us a community of loved ones who are going through their own struggles and hardships. We have named them in our hearts in our own prayers to you, but as we come together now, we name them out loud to you. O God, we pray for Barbara and Norman. We pray for Marcia and Annika, Bridget and Jean. We pray for Joe and Ben. We pray for Cindy. Pray for Don and Rita, for Pat, for Linda, for Chris. Oh God, you are with them all the time. We know that you have not abandoned them, but we ask that you allow them to feel your presence just a little bit stronger still. Allow them to know that they are not alone, and that they are loved by you and by us. And even now, O God, we come to you as a community, but we also come bearing our own fears and anxieties. anxieties, our own worries, and our own sins. Hoping that when we have a moment with you, that you may take them. And we give you thanks, for you are the only one who knows us fully, and despite all of our flaws and insecurities, you love us just as we are. And that you would take everything which holds us down, if only we would let it go and offer it up to you. And so we take this time now to do so in silence, knowing that you alone have the power to hear these prayers. And you alone have the power to respond. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks and praise, for you are slow to anger, but you are quick to compassion and mercy. Your steadfast love in our lives endures forever. And even though we make mistakes, even though we stumble and fall, you are there to catch us each and every time. And if we turn back to you, you will set us on your path of justice and righteousness. We give you thanks for everything, for the moments that allow us to grow, for the moments that allow us to love and feel loved, for the moments in which we experience your joy, and for the moments in which we feel at peace with the world around us. We give you thanks for your Son, Jesus the Christ, your Word made flesh to dwell among us. In this Christmas season, you come down as one of us. You lived in the same world we lived in. You experienced the same hardships we experienced, all so that you could triumph over it all with the power of your love. And also so that we could follow your example and triumph over this world with the power of your love. And so, in thanks and recognition of the gifts you are giving us, have continued to give us, we join now in the prayer that you have taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our
Thank you, choir, and a special thank you to Emily Knapp for the flute. Our second reading is from the Gospel according to Luke, the second chapter, verses 39 through 52. Luke 2, 39. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. As the child grew and became strong, he was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the feast according to the custom. After the feast was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they traveled on for a day. Then they began looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him there. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. Now, when his parents saw him, they were astonished. And then his mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. Amen.
Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts, and even all of our words, honestly, today, be acceptable and pleasing unto you, for you alone are our rock and our redeemer. So, I felt like mixing it up a little bit today. Maybe the jacket was the first thing you got. But it occurred to me, it has been so long since you and I, you at home and here in the pews, have actually had like a real conversation about what we find in the text, a la, you know, children's chat, even though really, children's chat for everybody. And so, what I'd like to do is I'd like to start by asking you a question, because your participation is required today at some level. Who had a good Christmas day? Let's just start there. Start simple. You can raise your hand, you don't have to yell. Wonderful. And I hope it was filled with really cool gifts and, you know, even amazing time spent with family or loved ones. I went to the movies, and then, much to the surprise of quite a few people, I went and got Chinese food. Because apparently I was the only one in like a 10-mile radius that knew the Chinese restaurants were open on Christmas Day. And I also learned that there's a positive correlation between the people who didn't know that between the people who had not seen The Christmas Story. It's a classic. I would recommend checking that out. You know, a lot of the times when we sit and we have our chats, more one-sided, because I tend to monologue for quite a bit, we talk about what's in the text, which sounds like that makes sense. That's what we should do. We shouldn't be making up stories to talk about God and how God works with us. But what I wanted to do today today with something a little bit different. I wanted to talk for just a little bit today about what's not in the text, about what's missing, what we don't have. So Will read the story where Jesus is found at the temple. And does anybody remember about how old Jesus is? He said it. 12. Very good. Very good. And so we're going to keep, I'm just going to flip a page here. And so that's a story we have about Jesus. And then Luke goes to talk about John the Baptist, which is exciting, but we're going to skip it. And okay, John the Baptist, John the Baptist. And now the next story we have with Jesus in it is his baptism. All right? And I want you to notice if something seems a little, what stands out to you? All right? I'll read when I get to the point I want you to notice. This is chapter 3, starting in verse 21. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came down from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love, and with you I am well pleased." I always think God's a bass, right? Now, Jesus himself was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. What stands out to you? That's where I'm going to end. What stands out? Jesus is 30 years old, yeah. So, the last story we had, Jesus was 12. And now, Jesus is 30. What has happened in 18 years? Because, look, we read the story of Jesus being 12 at the temple, and it's pretty incredible, is it not? I mean, full of the symbolism with the 3 days. He can't be found, and then he's found in the temple. And he's 12, and he's having these kind of word battles with the teachers and the rabbis in there. And so we read that, and maybe you're like me, and you think, okay, well, this is going to be good. I can't wait to see what he does when he's 13, you know? But we have nothing. And I kept wondering why. Now, those of you who participate in our Bible study, which we'll be picking back up in January, by the way, Thursdays from 11 to noon, and you're welcome to tune into that on Facebook as well. We ask this question a lot. Well, why isn't this thing in the text? Why is this one story missing? Or why is this told in a certain way? Or I'm really curious about what happens outside of the story. And the unfortunate answer that comes time and time again is that it's not in the text because the author didn't think it was important. Or that there just isn't anything. And with some stories, I'm kind of okay with that answer. You know, it doesn't always have to be about me and the things I want to know, and maybe you can see that too. But I wonder if there is something really important with the fact that Jesus lives 18 years with no miracles, no weird word fights with rabbis, no walking on water across the kiddie pool, no anything that would point to him being anything more than just a regular kid, and even young adult. I wonder, for some of you, how many of you waited until Christmas Day to open all of your gifts this year? Myself included. Why? most of them, but we just can't help it. You know, we just need to know exactly what is in that envelope or what is in that box. And I think that's actually a smaller kind of clue to basically how we've lived our lives for the past maybe 20 years and how it'll probably go even further into the future. I have in my pocket the world, in essence. There is no fact that is unknowable because I hold this in my hand. And some of people are better at talking to Siri than I am, but Siri can find you anything, or Cortana, or your Google Assistant, you know, whatever you call it. The whole world is at our fingertips, and it doesn't even take that much time in an instant. And I can go on this phone, and I can go on to one of my favorite websites, you know, especially around this time of year, Amazon, and I can find things that I like or do my gift shopping, and I can have it at my door in 2 days or less. I want to watch a particular movie. Maybe it's not in theaters, but I just want to rent it. I can go on my smart TV, right? I got a little Roku stick in the back of it, so it makes my TV pretty smart. And I can literally pull the button on my remote and say the name of the movie I want to watch. And it pops up different ways I can watch it, whether I pay for it or not. We live in a world where things happen really fast. And my guess is they're just going to keep speeding up. Things are only going to get better on that front. But I wonder if there's a reason why Jesus doesn't just grow up doing miracles from like the age of 5 on. I wonder if there's a reason why Jesus waits 18 years to really get started in his ministry. I wonder if that reason is so God could have a fully human experience. That maybe Jesus, just like us, went to school and got a bad grade. Or had relationships that failed. Maybe even cried when his girlfriend left him. Maybe experienced the joy of receiving a gift from somebody else, or even the joy of giving a gift to someone else. Maybe Jesus tried carpentry, and maybe Jesus wasn't that good at it. But what's so amazing to me is what's not in here, the fact that Jesus grows and has a real human experience with us, so that at a very deep, fundamental level, not just because God made us and you know the things you make to a certain extent, but God actually lived a life among us, with us, and ultimately for us. And maybe there's a lesson in that about using this time we have not to just rush through things, but to take our time to really enjoy and find meaning in everything we encounter. Now, I want you to talk a little bit amongst yourselves while I go grab something, but I want you to talk about what the coolest gift you got this year was. All right? And go. You don't have much time left. All right, I hope it was really cool, I'm sure it was. And I wanted to share with you a little bit of the coolest thing I got this year. All right. Now, some of you may have to move to get a better view, I apologize. You know, I will, you know, here's what I'll do, I will stand up. And I'll hold it for just a little bit, and then I'm going to sit back down because I want to be comfortable too. I know what you're thinking, all right? Pastor Preston, it's real cool, man. poster of The Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 2. That feels a little bit random. I mean, that movie's pretty old now, isn't it? Well, not quite, but there's a story. So when I was just starting out, this would be about in the summer. It's summer this year, it'll be 6 years. So we're just on maybe the like 5.5 years ago. I was a director of youth ministry at Waterford Central United Methodist Church in Waterford, Michigan. And it was a crazy ride how I got there, from finding a last ditch, like skin of my teeth internship that I needed to get my undergraduate degree. And then this job just kind of fell in my lap. You know, it's kind of amazing how God works in that way sometimes. And we decided that for the next few Januaries, to welcome people back in kind of a fun way to get folks back into the pews and get us back into that worship in spirit, we would do Central Church at the Movies. Okay? And so you'd go see a movie, and then you'd hear us talk about it on Sundays. And so this was one of the few series in which I was given a slot. This would be, I would get a week to preach. And this is kind of how the conversation actually went. We were sitting trying to figure out what movies we were going to do at the staff meeting, and people go, you know, I think it might be really cool if Preston got an edgy movie. You know, something real action-y that like people want to go and see. And so we picked, at the time, The Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 2 was just out in theaters. And so we said, hey, at this time, come and watch Mockingjay Part 2, and on Sunday you'll hear about it. Nobody came to the movie. It was me and like three other people. I did not know them. But it was like, yeah, it was the second sermon I've ever preached. And it's 5.5 years ago, and so I as I left to go to seminary, I asked if I could keep the poster. I thought it'd be a cool memento, and they let me. It was very nice. And so I got a call about a couple months ago, because my parents are downsizing, and they said, hey, we still have this poster just hanging out here. Do you really want this? Would you like it framed or something? And I thought for a minute. And in that minute, I thought of all the crazy things that had happened in just 5.5 years. Now, I know, well, I don't know, so I'm just going to ask. How many of you feel 5.5 years is a long time? Some of you are laughing like it's not a long time. But I think the point is that 5.5 years is a long time. Things fly by real fast. And I think we miss how long, and we lose an appreciation for how long time actually is and how it keeps going. And I thought about this as I opened it today, and it took me back. Every single milestone, tragedy, loss, but also joy that had happened in 5.5 years, where I packed up everything, moved to Ohio, and now here I find myself still in Ohio. I actually never thought I would be here, honestly. I thought I'd be back in Michigan. That's how I saw my life playing out 5.5 years ago, and just how much that has changed. And how much I have been blessed by the change. And I wonder if that's the point. I wonder if for this year ahead, let's try and take it literally one day at a time. Let's go into each day asking how we can grow just a little bit, how we can learn something new, just a little bit more today, how we can learn to appreciate the things around us just a little bit more each and every day, because Jesus takes 18 years to mature and grow. like one of us. We're thankful that you had ups and downs just like we did, that you felt happy some days and some days you felt sad. Because sometimes it's really hard to feel like people feel exactly how we do. When we're sad, it sometimes feels like we're alone, that nobody knows what we're going through. And we're thankful that in you, and through your Son, Jesus Christ, that you know exactly what we're going through, and that you're with us each and every day, and you love us, in spite of it all, just as we are. Amen. Christ, who comes this season to save us through grace, and through the power of God's Holy Spirit that will strengthen and sustain us all until we meet again. Amen.